wherever you'd like. If we can get,
I didn't come from very far away. It was just West Seattle.
Well, and we're going to talk.
Yeah,
that.
Whidbey Island. I mean,
that's well. Hank came the farthest. Hank drove all the way up from Santa Monica, fighting forest fires all the way.
Mm. West Santa Monica, yeah. To be specific.
So, starting down at the far end, Hank Rosenfeld has a particular tie with today's show, in that he wrote Irving Brecher's biography, and Irving Brecher created The Life of Riley, along with many other things that he wrote. So we'll talk a little bit about that. You probably know and recognize Lauren from The Love Boat, where she was Julie McCoy. And David was part of the Firesign Theater group. David has appeared with us a few times.
A few times. Actually, in the very first Reps season, which was about 20 years ago.
Okay. And the last showcase we did.
And the last showcase. But the first one was The Shadow and Dimension X. Those two I remember directing. That was fabulous.
Wow.
Yeah.
You remember? That's impressive.
Oh, I don't do old radio that often, you know.
And Hank, as I already said, wrote the biography. Lauren, how did you end up in West Seattle? What brought you to this part of the country?
My late husband lived here in Seattle, and I moved up here in 1994.
So you've been up here for what? You came up and you stayed?
I did, because there was a lot of live theater here, and I was pretty washed up in L.A., so I was able to work.
And you worked with Imagination Theater and our good friend Mr. Albert, who I know is out there somewhere.
I have worked lots of times for Larry and Jim, and that's always a fun thing to do. And I have had a good voiceover career.
I know you did some video game work.
I did, but not so much. I haven't done any in a long time.
Okay. So, as I said, most people know and remember you from Love Boat.
Yes.
But you did a lot of other stuff.
Well,
mainly TV, is that fair? A lot of guest shots?
A lot of guest shots on Aaron Spelling shows.
For Mr. Spelling, man.
Yeah, because okay. Love Boat was an Aaron Spelling show. So it just kind of works that way.
So I remember when Love Boat first came on, and I kind of think
1977.
I was three. Okay, so first of all, let me say you weren't supposed to laugh at that.
Well, I was 23.
That's about seems about right. I remember when I think of Love Boat, I think of Love Boat and Fantasy Island, which was also Spelling, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
And those two shows, I felt, were kind of unique in their presentation in that they were always bringing on big-name guest stars every week.
Mm-hmm.
What was it like working on a show where you're working with different stars every week?
It was a really unique and valuable acting school, because I worked with big stars that I didn't even know who they were. And I
old timers. People have been around for a while?
I didn't know. I never watched films or much television as a kid, so I didn't know most of the guest stars.
Okay.
And it was before the internet. So Couldn't Google anybody. And there was a new batch every week. And I was the youngest at the beginning. And I was always getting in trouble for not knowing who my guests were this week. So, I don't know what to do about that. So I had a book, and I'd look people up, and I'd try to memorize something about them. But the truth is, the bigger the star, the smaller the need for me to know anything about them, because they were the nicest people in the world. And there were also a lot of guest stars on the show that were just new people on ABC shows.
Promoting.
They were harder to get along with sometimes than... I mean, you couldn't be nicer than Ruth Gordon. really, or Vincent Price, or...
And that was going to lead me to my next question. Who is your favorite person to work with?
Vincent Price.
Really? Nice. Why?
Because coming from my background, I come from a lower middle class background in Southern California, and I had never met a gentleman until I met, and I, there's, you, this might surprise you, but there's not a lot of show business producer gentlemen.
It would have surprised us maybe till about 6 months ago.
Never surprised me. But Vincent Price was smart and funny and kind and knew everything about fine art.
And he was an artist in his own right.
Yes, and music and food and wine. And he would talk about those things to me while we were sitting around in Halloween costumes, because it was Vincent Price, so of course it was the Halloween episode.
Because everybody always thinks that he's doing this scary movie.
And he would be Dracula, and I think I was in Cleopatra's clothes. I think I met him when I was doing the episode where I wore Elizabeth Taylor's real costume from the Cleopatra.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. We were working at 20th Century Fox, which almost died because of that movie. But
so it's interesting that you mentioned Vincent Price, because he came up to Seattle one time and rented a boat from a friend of mine to spend a week on. And my friend had no idea who he was. He just didn't follow cinema or anything. And he said exactly the same thing. Nicest guy in the world, took great care of my boat, and overpaid.
Yeah.
When it was done, paid him more than they had agreed on, and it wasn't until he saw the signed check. Vincent Price, that name sounds familiar.
My favorite part about Vincent Price, besides that initial, like, wow, this is what a man can be, you know, and that was pretty interesting news for me. But he's also, he and his wife were wonderful cooks, and in the 70s, they wrote a cookbook called a Treasury of Great Recipes. It's out of print, but if you can ever find it, you should get it. And he and his wife went around Europe in a motorhome and went to all the great restaurants of Europe and ate the food and took pictures. There included the menus from, great recipes and great restaurants. And then they would go back to their motorhome and try to recreate the dishes they had. And if they couldn't figure it out, then they'd go back and talk to the chef. Well, as a second career when I turned 50, I decided to go to culinary school. I don't know why I did that. But I still make his lasagnas, really the point of my story. But they are wonderful recipes. And it's so fascinating to look at the prices, you know, to be in Venice. And, oh, look, the steak is $4. You know, it's just great, but the 70s. And it's all those brown colors that everything from the 70s is.
Okay, so now I got to put you on the spot. Least favorite. Name names.
I won't do that.
Can you describe them? Or tell why were they your least favorite?
You know, to be honest, I think our world right now is so full of ugly stuff, I don't want to help.
Okay, that's fine. That's a fair answer. Fair answer. Okay. David, you have a background working in radio and radio stations. You were back on the East Coast, and then you moved out to L.A., and that's where Firesign began.
That's quickly a summary, yeah. No, I started in as a summer replacement announcer on WBAI-FM, New York City.
Somebody said yay. You know that station? Are you from
New York? Well, it was a commercial station when I started on it. So I remember having to do a record show, and the beginning of it was a piece of music went dum 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 dum, and then there were two bar pause, and then went dum dum dum, and you had to say, Florence presents music out of the night, or something like that, in that little spot. I was learning. The Russian guy would call me up and correct my pronunciation. That was good. New York, you know, they're... So, yeah, 1959, and then I moved out. I did my first radio series, which is
which one?
No, the black and white one. There it is, called The Sullen Art. I interviewed about 50 poets and little magazines. There were little magazines then. At this time, the first ever interview, radio interview with Allen Ginsberg, first one with Leroy Jones and Mary Baraka, and virtually everybody. So that whole collection I took with me from New York and carried and carried and carried until I finally didn't have any money. And I thought, who's gonna, gonna buy this collection? It went to the University of Toledo. And so for years I would knock on their door and say, you know, this is a really nice archive, you should, And so finally there was somebody there and there's that came out with a CD. And so that's 1960, 61. That's old radio. That really is old radio. And that was where I started as an interviewer and a, you know, an FM DJ.
And let me just interject for a second. We have a limited number of copies of a number of books from Firesign Theater, and then we'll talk about Hank's book as well that we'll be selling and they will be signing after the show. So if it's something that interests you, we'll be back there so you can pick up a copy of that.
Yeah, then I moved to Los Angeles at KPFK, and it was at KPFK in 1966 that Peter Bergman was a rising star in radio in Los Angeles with Radio Free Oz, and I sat in on his program. We did we did I Ching, or we did tarot, three card tarot. People would call up and we'd read their tarot cards on the air. This was a federal crime. Yeah, you cannot do that on the radio. People, very confusing to people. And that we did that, and my partner Phil Austin was his engineer, and his great friend from Yale, Phil Proctor, came to Los Angeles to cover riots. There were a lot of riots going on in LA at that time involving young people. And in order not to mess his New York pants, he spread a copy of the Free Press down on, sat on it, covered the riot which was going on around him. And when he got up, he realized he had been sitting on a picture of Peter Bergman, his old friend from Yale University. So he looked him up. So the four of us, for the first time, were in the studio, and Peter, and we're going to do the Oz Film Festival. We're each going to play two different people, and we're going to show movies on the radio. And they're experimental films. And so we're standing at the door to the studio, and Peter says, do you mind if I call you the Firesign Theater, the Oz Firesign Theater? And we said, no, that's fine, Pete. Let's just do the show.
Why? Tell them why it was Firesign Theater.
It was Radio Free Oz, and it was Firesign because, doesn't everybody know Leo's Sagittarius? You know, Firesign.
Apparently not.
The
60s.
Aries, right, yeah, the three of them. And so we were, in fact, two Sagittariuses, one Aries and one Leo, and that was the Firesign Theater. This came out of Peter's mouth. We went on the air, and we showed these movies, and we had a little sound effect, you know, the movie showing. And the moment came where Phil Austin, who was playing sort of a not nasty British time, he was showing a film called Ants and Tangerines, and suddenly it wasn't about ants and tangerines at all. And Peter got very unhappy with this movie, and he demanded that it be shut down. So we shut down that movie. Remember, this is the radio. Phone starts ringing immediately. How can you censor that man's film? He can show anything he wants. Well, we realized what Orson Welles realized. You can fool them all of the time. And so the birth of the Firesign Theater was knowing that whatever we said people would believe, they did. They just believed us. That's what television can't do. Yeah. You know, radio can. So I love this medium. This is mine, this medium.
The first fake news.
Oh, weren't we ever? We were right. Oh, fake news. Well, on beyond that.
So Firesign Theater went on for how many years?
Well, I consider it, so long as Phil and I are still alive, it's still going on.
So
I'm still, Phil Proctor and I are still the Firesign Theater. Yeah, we have books coming out constantly.
I know Phil just wrote a book.
Oh, yeah. That's 55 years, 53 years.
So what you may not know is that the Firesign Theater just had their archives purchased by the Library of Congress.
Yay.
For $500,000.
Oh!
Yeah, right? Phil didn't tell you. You look confused.
I have to talk to the treasurer about this.
That's Phil.
We like to say acquired.
Okay.
By the Library of Congress. It's more dignified.
Money's money.
But yeah, it was the place for it to go. And as I've been telling various people, the amount of stuff that left Los Angeles was a ton.
Literally a ton.
2,000 pounds was packed up and shipped to Virginia.
Wow.
And then I had another 25 boxes from my, so we had 50 years of archives. And
but it's all there now.
It's all there now in Culpeper, Virginia.
And we've got a commitment from David and Phil for the 2019 showcase to do the performance that they did at the Library of Congress.
There you go, an even better version.
The Art of Radio, is that what it is?
The Art of Radio.
The Art of Radio. So that'd be pretty cool. And the other thing that I want to mention, award nominees up here. I was able to go to the Grammy Museum this summer with Phil. Firesign Theater has 3 Grammy nominations for Best Comedy Album. That's pretty impressive. And Lauren probably doesn't want me to mention this, Golden Globe nominee. That's pretty impressive too.
Yeah.
Hank, on the other hand, has nothing.
Yeah. Wait. Here's a book.
Before we start, I just want to tell David I've memorized your first 3 albums. And for Lauren,
cool.
Can I watch you on YouTube now?
Yeah.
These days?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
You can't get away from it.
Looking forward to it.
Well, I've been trying.
You've been trying. Lauren, do people recognize you?
No.
They don't? Even when you wear the name tag?
If I'm on a ship in a navy blue suit, yes. Especially if I'm holding something like this.
Very good. So before we move down to Hank.
Suddenly you're there.
Yeah.
That's it. Oh, it's this.
You still know my name. I know all my lines. Hi, welcome aboard. Bye, thanks for sailing with us.
Very impressive. I'm not going to see your hands, but if you guys have, if there's anybody out there that has an iPhone, Phil showed me this summer, the little Easter egg.
Yes, there are several Firesign Easter eggs.
Before I tell them, what was the connection with Steve Jobs?
Well, Peter was totally tied in with Apple very early on. I mean, we were Apple people from the very beginning, and Peter's other life when he wasn't in comedy was in something else, he was an Apple fellow before we even knew that existed. So he was there. He, you know, in the this was basically 90s, I think. You know, late 80s and 90s, early on.
Let me show you. Let me see if I can show you one of the Easter eggs. I have an iPhone. I'm going to give it to you. Hey Siri.
Why did the porridge bird lay his egg in the air?
My web search turned something up for why did the porridge bird lay his egg in the air. Have a look.
Didn't work. There's one where you say hello. You remember that one?
Well, hello? No, I don't.
There's more to it. I'll find it while we talk.
No, it should answer it.
There's one. I'll get it to work for you. Hank wrote... Hold your book up since I had it here to hold up and you took it. The Wicked Wit of the West is what they called Irving Brecher. Irving Brecher was the voice of Groucho Marx. How much time did you spend with Irv writing that book?
6 years, 3 months, and 22 days, Dan.
About. A lot of time.
He was a master craftsman and a perfectionist, so he was constantly rewriting to make sure it was exactly right, to his memory.
So you're going to find out today, if you didn't already know, Irving Brecher created The Life of Riley, which is the tie-in with that. But that probably is not what he's best known for. Is that fair?
Well, he wrote two Marx Brothers movies, and then he went to MGM and wrote Meet Me in St. Louis, and a bunch of other musicals like that, Yolanda and the Thief, Du Barry Was a Lady. And the last one he wrote was Bye Bye Birdie, which came from a Broadway stage, and he adapted it to screen.
So a lot of people don't maybe recognize the name Irving Brecher, but he did some big-time stuff, including Return of the Thin Man?
Shadow.
Shadow of the Thin Man. Shadow of the Thin Man. So he did that. I got to tell you, I've read this book, and it's fantastic. It's a conversation with Brecher, some of his adventures with Groucho Marx. Talk about the creation of The Life of Riley, because I don't think most people realize how it came about.
Well, that was originally for Groucho Marx, as a radio show called The Flotsam Family. People didn't accept Groucho as anything but Groucho. So it kind of failed as a pilot, and they would put it on a 33 RPM disc at that point. And it just kind of disappeared. And then he got a call from an ad agency in Chicago, and so we found this thing in the bottom of the pile, and we'd like to do it as a radio show. So in 1943, he just finished Meet Me in St. Louis, which came out in 44, and he went ahead and did this radio show with William Bendix and all these other great actors, and it became a movie in 1949, and then a television show right after that. And it won the first Emmy. Before they had sitcoms, it was a best filmed comedy series. And he has an Emmy, so. I would go over almost every day. He was 88 when I met him, and he survived the whole Bush administration, the last 8 years. And when Obama took office, Irv died. He said, "That's okay, I've left the country in better hands."
Where did you end up leaving the computer? Is it down here?
It's on the piano.
It's on the piano?
If
you get a chance, take a peek.
There's
a bunch of photos up there from The Life of Riley. Our good friend Tommy Cook played Junior, and there's a couple shots of him as a very young Tommy Cook. Interestingly, he's the same height, but the same. You'll recognize him. So it didn't sell. That he couldn't sell it with Groucho. They didn't see Groucho as Riley, which really isn't surprising. So then he repackaged it, rewrote it, and yeah. It became The Life of Riley. The original Riley was?
Well, William Bendix on the radio.
For not a very long time, is that right?
No, for the whole radio, which I think was years.
Was it?
Yeah. But it was originally sponsored by the American Meat Institute. It was during the war, and there wasn't a lot of meat, but they wanted to keep their name up there. Uh-huh.
Like everybody would have forgotten.
Where the meat?
And then Pabst Blue Ribbon became the later sponsor, and that was always his sponsor for radio. But when it went to TV, William Bendix was like, he was a little sick of the character, because Bendix became so popular, Riley became so popular, that people go, "Hey, Riley," and all that. And he didn't like that. So when it came time to do television, he'd done the film in 49, directed by Irv, he didn't want to do it. He didn't think television was a thing. It's just a fad, a passing trend. So Irv got, he auditioned some people, and he ended up with Jackie Gleason playing Riley the first season on television. He was slim. It was before the Honeymooners and all that. And then Bendix came along the second season.
Gleason just did it for a year.
Gleason was in. Then he left. Got hired by this was NBC. He got hired by the Dumont Network, and then he created the Honeymooners.
Jackie Gleason show first, right? Didn't the Honeymooners come out? Wasn't it a segment on?
Yeah.
I think that's true.
Yeah.
I don't recall.
You would know.
Okay.
You know,
and away we go.
Yeah.
No, the Jackie.
That came. That was a later version. I think that came later. And away we go.
Jackie Gleason show. That was live from Florida.
Yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think there was an earlier version. Yeah. Maybe it wasn't called the Jackie Gleason. Does anybody remember?
American Scene Magazine.
There we go.
That was a show from Florida. Gleason had a live show in the mid-50s, and that was where the Honeymooners, but he was on the Dumont Network, and the Honeymooners came out of original skits on that Cavalcade of something.
Cavalcade of Stars, Larry?
Maybe. And Herb Kelly was the original Alice. When he moved to CBS with the well-known show from the 50s, that's when he got, I can't remember his name, somebody help me. Audrey
Meadows.
It's all there.
So, this is sort of interesting about doing television then. The television series emanated from New York live, and it was broadcast simultaneously in cities in the eastern and central parts of the U.S. There was no transcontinental cable, no carrier from New York to California. So the show had to be kinescoped. I'm sure you all know what that is. Photographed in film off the TV screen.
Which a lot of the Honeymooner episodes were also in kinescope.
Were they?
Yeah, so there's, if you ever watch them on TV now, they're kind of fuzzy. That's why, because you're watching kinescopes.
And then the kinescope would be shipped.
On the West Coast, that's all you got.
Yeah.
The kinescope would be shipped to Los Angeles and San Francisco, where it was shown with a kind of fuzzy quality to the cities west of the Rocky Mountains. It was like a second-class version. It wasn't until coaxial cable was laid across the U.S. that kinescopes were no longer needed. Amazing.
You know, the technology that goes on is amazing. I don't know how many of you know this, but I teach high school, and you can't talk to kids about cassette tapes. Nobody has CDs anymore. So trying to talk to them about, you know, remember when your TVs used to get the vertical hold problem?
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't happen anymore because everything is digital.
You know when it happened the first time?
I don't know.
When they started to roll tape. And when they roll tape into a live broadcast, it would always roll over. Always.
And it wasn't until the Outer Limits when they controlled the vertical.
That's right. Then it worked.
There we go.
Thank God for that.
Love that show. We are now returning control of your televisions.
Can't do that anymore.
No. Now they have total control and they sell your names to different companies. So, just as a group now, what are your reminiscences? What are your memories?
Yeah.
What are your memories of radio shows? I know that Lauren and I weren't around. Hank, you weren't around. David, did you listen to radio? Did you make it back?
First radio show I ever heard. I finally identified. It was, I think, called Latitude Zero. Anybody remember it? Had one season, 1941. I remember because I was five, and it happened. And my birthday is the day before Pearl Harbor. And so I remember listening to Pearl Harbor on the radio, you know, the news, but that show was really scary. And as a 4 or 5 year old, it terrified me. Latitude or Longitude Zero, whatever it was. And it's actually in one of the, you know, one of the big reference volumes. I have never Googled it, but it's actually in a book. You know, isn't that a nice book? I have a book in my library. I can go to my book and look things up in my book.
Hey, you can't talk to high school students about books either. Everything's online now.
I know.
Lauren, did you listen to radio?
Well, my grandfather used to listen to the horse races a lot on the radio.
That's a whole other show.
And my older brother listened to Firesign Theater, so I did listen to them, but never got it.
You were a girl.
I wasn't cool enough. Now
you got it.
Yeah.
Hank? Or sorry, did I cut you?
No, that's all I got.
Hank?
Radio? I watched The Life of Riley on television with my dad in the 60s. It came back into syndication.
As did I.
Which was great.
With my dad, too.
Yeah. It's a real bonding.
Your dad wouldn't watch it with me.
That was before the dad became Homer Simpson. This was the Riley version, working class, El Segundo, airplane parts. Anyway, radio, I grew up in Detroit, so I was one of those kids with the transistor under the pillow.
Okay.
I would pick up stations from Wheeling, West Virginia, from Cincinnati, and New Orleans. And it was just magic to me to pick up WBZ from Boston and listen to those people talk.
100,000 watts of effective radiated power.
Wow. So I found the Easter egg, so I can get that to work now.
Oh.
While I'm doing that, Jim, I can't see you. Can you fire up that hand mic and let's turn the lights up and see if there's any questions? We'll let the audience get involved. Here's the Easter egg.
You guys know more than me.
In a second. Hey, Siri. This is Worker speaking.
Hello, Aklem. What function can I perform for you? LOL.
That's the only one that I knew. Apparently, yeah. There's more.
Well, there are at least two or three that I know of.
Now, and what?
I don't get it. What's the Easter egg part of it?
It's something that's hidden that you have to discover on your own if you're under 25.
Oh.
They don't tell you about it. It's kind of like you've heard the hidden Mickeys at Disneyland.
Yeah.
Okay.
I used to drink at that bar with the hidden
Mickeys. Hidden Mickey.
That's right. Hidden Mickey.
There we go.
The fire smell. Yeah. Yeah, they had ears.
I'm learning
on the
a
glass
lot here tonight.
Wait, this is all a bonus. Is the microphone ready? Go ahead. Questions. Anybody have a question for anybody except me?
Can there be?
There you go. Right up front. The rude gentleman who was annoying us at the start of the show.
There's a rumor that there'll be an Easter egg in this radio piece. So pay attention.
So, wow.
Yeah.
So a question to the young lady up on the stage. So you are basically a regular on the Love Boat, week in, week out. And now when you read from your script, besides holding the pad and the pencil and all that, did you take a character with you when you left the scene? You at your age, you started developing the idiosyncrasies of that character?
No, I've always been grumpier than Julie McCoy was. I'm much crazy.
Everybody was grumpier than Julie McCoy was.
But if you have the time, the interesting thing is when I was cast in the role of Julie McCoy, and I was cast the night before before the pilot shot.
From a very large group of actors, I might add.
Wow.
And I didn't know what I was doing. But my audition day started because, you remember Mary Tyler Moore was on the air at the time, and, hi Sheila. Hi. My friend is here. But
it's good to have friends.
The character that I went into audition for was going to be a women's libber, able to stand up to that captain. And because a cruise director really is a senior officer of the ship, and they were men, except for the woman who wrote the book, The Love Boats. So I started the audition day being sort of, being a woman in charge with an important job, and I would finish my audition, and then the casting people would get together and say, okay, when you come in the next time, could you just soften it a little bit? Just maybe take a little of that edge off. And I went in and out of the room, I think, 5 times. And by the end of it, I was, hey, what's going on? And that's what I got cast as. So I don't know what they did to the other people or what happened to that character, but she never came back.
Somebody else.
How did you get into show business? Did you have an interest as a child?
I did have an interest as a child. We moved to California from Pennsylvania when I was 8. And I didn't do a good job of making friends. So by the time I was 12, we moved a lot in the first couple of years. And when I was 12, there was one girl that was kind of friendly with me at school. And there was I grew up in Whittier, California, famous place. Me and Richard Nixon.
Mm-hmm.
So much in common. that I auditioned for a play at Whittier junior theater, which was the children's theater, and it was Hans Brinker and the Silver Skates, and I was cast as Katrina Fleck, and my friend was not cast. So she wasn't my friend anymore. And, kind of show business story, but true. So I started doing that, and I did speech things in school, and I studied theater in college, and then I studied film acting.
So. Somebody else? We'll run it back to you, Sean.
Do you have any props from the show?
She actually has the boat.
Interesting you should ask. I do. And I don't think anybody else does, because I found my name tag the other day, which, I mean, I went through a lot of those over the years. But I've been a waitress a lot, and I worked as a cheese seller and a cook, so I've had a lot of name tags in my life, and I save them all. So, but I have the sign from, I think it says, do not open without permission from the bridge. I have a sign that was someplace. I have the sign from my office door. But when they replaced me with a character named Judy McCoy. So the door says J. McCoy. Because they figured nobody would notice, you know, both women. I mean, they really meant that. They really didn't think anybody would notice. So she was Judy and I was Julie. So I have a sign that says J. McCoy. And I have one that says something about a dinner seating in the dining room. And I took those on the last day when the show wrapped, because I went back to the show at the end. And on the very last day, as we were filming, and we shot it on film, so they were just tearing the set apart behind us. And things were just going into the dumpster while we were filming. And pretty much by the end of the day, it was just people and some marks on the floor and bye-bye. Yeah. Yeah.
So check eBay later this week.
I don't think it worked for anybody but me.
What else? Larry.
For Hank, why Irving Brecher?
Well, Turner Network, TCM, I don't know how many of you watch the Turner Classic Movie Network, it's the best. They are in Atlanta, and they would come to L.A. once every few years and try to get as many people on tape as they could before they died. Props people, stunt people, makeup people, Hollywood figures, which they would use. Actually, it was based on Steven Spielberg's Holocaust project, interviewing survivors before they weren't around anymore to tell their story. Mm. So they held it in the Hilton Hotel, and I read one season, they said, it was a friend called me, said, they're interviewing this guy who wrote Marx Brothers movies. And then they take the tapes and put them between their movies, you know, back on Turner. I said, Marx Brothers? Is somebody still around? So I went to the Hilton Hotel, and I listened to him do this interview, this skinny old man with bony fingers, and he just held court for 90 minutes. And, I mean, funny stories, and I just chased him out of the building, basically, and said, how come I never read your memoir? Irving Brecher? What? He says he was the only guy in Hollywood that didn't change his name. Anyway, it took me about 6 months, and his wife and daughter convinced him that he should leave something for them, because he never did anything else for them. That's the way he said it. He was like Groucho, because Groucho was his best friend, so he dressed up like Groucho as a kid.
Tell him that story.
He played Groucho. One time Groucho was sick during the publicity tour, posters. Irv stepped in, played Groucho. He was like 22. All the Marx Brothers by that time were in their 40s.
So, there's a publicity photo in Hank's book of the three Marx Brothers. Only two of them are Marx Brothers. Groucho is Irving Brecher.
Yeah.
They had him fill in. And just a little bit of trivia for you, they just came out with this great pictorial book of the Marx Brothers. And the author is trying to track down the original of that picture to put in volume 2 of the book. And he got it kind of in a roundabout way. He's chasing this down, and word of it got to me. So I contacted him and told him, I said, well, the picture is in Hank's book. And I made this like a 108 I think. I gave him the page number where I can find it, but he wants the original. Mm. And Irv would not release. He said the family would, he got all these pictures of the Marx Brothers, everything from Irv, but he would not release that one picture because he wanted to have it in his own book. And that's the book. And I remember seeing the picture for the first time, you know, long before I knew this story, long before I'd ever met Hank. I saw this picture and I said, something's not right. I never knew that it wasn't Groucho. And then when I saw it, now when you look at it, it's obviously not Groucho.
Yeah. Oh, you probably can't tell from here it's not Groucho, man.
I couldn't tell from here the first time. A couple more questions.
Thank you, Larry.
Sir.
This is for David. In your Firesign Theater, Waiting for the Electrician, you did kind of an homage to America.
That's a good word.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes.
That was a kind of a theatrical production from the 40s? Was it kind of an homage to Norman Corwin?
How can you be in two places at once?
Oh, that's what.
Babes and Khaki.
Yes, we called it the American Pageant. And we did it many, many, many times, mostly every time rewritten, which was the habit of the Firesign Theater. Why can't we do the same thing we did last time? Okay, we're doing it. Hmm. Is it better this way? Oh, it's better. Okay, good. That was a portrait. We wrote that in 1968, early in 68. Just check your phone for what was on then, you know? I mean, the country was a disaster area, and as it is frequently. And so we wanted to do in the manner of Norman Corwin, which is what we were really stealing, was Norman's all-in for America that he did during the Second World War. And so we were flipping that. As much as we admired Norman and loved him later, we flipped that. The country was at war, they were drafted. I mean, it was horrible. So our picture of that time as it is on that album, is completely politically incorrect. Completely, from beginning to end. And it almost was at the moment, you know. We thought by saying shit on one album that we were in real trouble, but they played, how can you be, over and over and over. So, and people have asked now to do it again live. We said, you can't do that script, because that script existed when it existed. But we were always very political. I mean, that was where we started, was really the first live radio shows, theater shows that we did, I mean, on stage. One was called Profiles in Barbecue Sauce, which proved conclusively that LBJ had shot Kennedy. And we had to stop doing that because the defense attorney was Bobby Kennedy, and then they shot him. So that show went, and we had to move on to the next political thing that we did, which was Hippie Faust. Okay, you discover that we came in with flick guns like this, you know, and everybody, and it's a radio show, and everybody's having a real good time, and everybody thought we had acid, you know, we were spraying acid on the audience. We were going like this, and so we brought somebody up, come on up, and he came up, and it's Phil Austin. Nobody knew any of us, and he came up, and we got him stoned, and then he went through a lifetime of hippie experience where he would discover that, you know, everything was really meaningful and really important, and maybe he should do something really important, and maybe he should communicate with people. So maybe he should get a newspaper going, and then this is a pretty good idea. And then there's the underground press syndicate, so we can get, and then the syndicate guys come in, you know. So eventually, at the end of this, when he comes down, you know, it's all, he realizes, oh, he's back with the family again, and dad, and the young. So that was the show we did several times at that time, totally off the wall. We were kind of, it was real political, underground political theater at that point. It was before we made any albums, or maybe we just made the first one. And I ran for vice president in 1976.
George Clooney. Oh,
In Santa Barbara, I got more votes than Peace and Freedom. We were the Natural Surrealist Party. And the slogan of our presidential candidate was George Papoon, who had a paper bag over his head so nobody would actually know who George Papoon was, so nobody would shoot him, funny enough. And, but George Tigerbiter ran for vice president, and...
Tigerbiter?
Yes, and our slogan was, not insane. Any other presidential candidate willing to make that admission? Not insane. So it was that lasted over a year. I did performance. It was crazy. Lawrence, Kansas. I'm in the middle of Kansas, and we're doing a rally for George Papoon. People are running in firearms. I mean, it was a great year. I did it for my country.
Thank you.
I did it for my country.
Thank you.
Hey, yeah. Yeah. Don't do it. it was really, the only thing we didn't do was report, we weren't authentic because we didn't report money. That would have involved us with serious.
As near as I can tell, then nobody's authentic.
Serious federal government problems. So we did avoid that. But it was real. It was as real as we could make it. We had cocoons for Papoon. In like 25 states. I mean, they were all over. People were doing art projects where they were. It was all a giant art project. And it's all in the Library of Congress. They can figure it out.
One more.
One.
Maybe not. There we go.
When you were doing the show... Lubbo.
Who were you talking? Lubbo?
Okay. Yes.
When the show first started, we had two sound stages at 20th Century Fox when they built the ship. And we did the pilot on the Queen Mary, but it was docked. I mean, it wasn't at sea. And then as the show got more successful, once it got on the air and it got more successful, they started to send us out on cruises, and so we... In the first year, I think we went on two cruises, or one maybe to Mexico, because we were shooting in Los Angeles, so getting to Mexico was easy. And as the show went on, we would do more and more cruises. And so that Mexico worked. Okay, good. Now let's try Alaska. That worked. We were always on different ships, but they would use the time on the when we were on the ships to get the stock footage for so that we could... stand in front of a curtain that was projected from the back of the studio. It's a process called process.
Clever.
And they would project a film of that scenery with a fan in front of us, and you had to stand exactly in a certain place and lean on the railing and not turn or, I mean, it was a little restrictive, but They did the stock footage every time we went out. And by the end of the show, well, at least my last cruise, we went to China and Japan and Hong Kong. And that was almost wow. 2 months we were at sea on different ships. And the network used the episodes that we filmed at sea for the big, big stars, the big guest stars, the Linda Evans kind of big stars. So going on the cruises was the best part for us because we just said, we had what we called a hello goodbye day where you wear a uniform and say hi, goodbye, and everybody either goes this way or this way. And the guest stars had to do all the work when we on the locations. So that was nice. My favorite place to go, favorite cruise was to Greece. That was amazing.
But did you interact with the audience on those cruises? Were there other, was the audience along?
They were. And in the beginning, the passengers were invited to be extras, and that was really fun for about 20 minutes. Because once I figured we had to do that same scene over and over again, and you're wearing your tuxedo and evening gown at 4, you know, 8 in the morning, and you are still wearing it at noon and still going, they found that we had to bring our own extras by the end.
So. That was a good question, eh?
Because people didn't like paying for their crews and being held prisoner by a film company.
But today, with the popularity of cruises, has there been a call for a reunion tour?
Yes, and in May, Princess Cruises organized this, but we, the cast of The Love Boat, got a star on Hollywood Boulevard.
Nice.
For an honorary star.
And what's an honorary star? 4 points?
Kind of tricky. There's money involved.
Oh.
Not for us. I mean, it's a public relations thing. The honorary part is for corporations. So there are only two. One of them is a vodka company, and where the Princess Cruises is the other. But my name's on the star, and
great.
They gave me my own copy, and it's in my dining room.
Nice. Very nice.
Down by the floor.
Down by the floor. Floor star.
So, I'm holding these up just so you can see what the covers look like, and David can talk to you about them more later. These will be available after the show. Hey, thanks everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Hope you all come back.